Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Jeb Smith here. Today, I want to talk about two topics that come up quite a lot in my videos where people are commenting and on lives asking questions, and that's the idea of a market crash, one, and two being, should you buy now or wait, or should you save more money and wait, however you want to phrase that question. Both of those things I want to take a little time and talk about. As many of you know, I'm a real estate broker here in Southern California. My channel has never been about fear. It's never been about, you know, anything other than trying to provide education. Education to first-time home buyers, education to buyers moving up, just to make people aware of the market so you can make rational decisions. As we know, most people buy emotionally and then justify logically. What we're trying to do is, you know, provide you with the information up front so that you can make logical decisions going through the home buying process. Well, that's tough in the environment that we're in. Right now, it's 2021. People are doing crazy things. There's this whole irrational buying craziness in the housing market right now where people are going well above the asking price, driving home prices up, multiple offers. And you know, it's ensuing this craziness. And then you got people that are sitting there thinking, well, do I jump in and buy now, having this fear of missing out, or should I wait and wait for home prices to come down in a couple of months and then I'll jump in then? Well, that's what I want to talk about. Before I do that, I want to talk about the idea of a housing crash. As many of you know, there's a lot of people on YouTube that are pushing the idea of a housing crash, that the market is going to pull back 30-50%. You know, by the end of the year, maybe sometime next year. And it's this doom and gloom mentality. And it's been like that since the beginning of the pandemic. You know, shortly after, you know, the world was shut down, if you will, there were YouTubers coming out and promoting fear, if you will. And fear is easy to promote because it scares people. And that scared type of mentality get people to, again, you know, fear for their lives, fear for, you know, their money. And with that, you know, people are scared. They're scared of the housing market. They're scared of the stock market just because of how things are moving and moving so quickly. But I want to take a minute and from a rational approach, right? Let's take the irrationality out of it, if that's even a word, and talk logic just for a little bit here. So, you know, we came into 2020 short on supply, right? There weren't a lot of houses on the market to start 2020, and then the pandemic hit. And that created this frenziness, right? People were now allowed to work from home. People no longer had to commute into work. They could move out of state if they want, work from remote locations, and they were seeking shelter, right? I mean, their home was their safe spot, and they needed a place not only that they could live, but one where the kids could run around, you know, you have room for being able to homeschool, you have room for having an office at home, all of these different factors playing into the housing market. And so people seek shelter at that time. And that added to, you know, a market that already had short supply, right? There weren't a lot of homes to begin with. Then you add people starting to buy homes, seeking shelter. And at the same time, interest rates went down. Interest rates went down for, you know, primarily to help save the economy, right? The Fed lowered the Fed funds rate to near zero to allow banks to borrow money cheaply. And, you know, this, you know, caused interest rates to also go low. And then this created this frenzy, right? People could now, you know, buy homes less expensive than they could a year before, even though prices had risen, right? They could still afford more property because interest rates had gotten so low. And this continued, this cycle continued through 2020. And at the same time, you had all of these people saying, housing crash at the end of 2020, housing crash in the third quarter of 2020, housing crash in the fourth quarter. Same people over and over and over again. Every week, new video promoting a housing crash. 2021 comes and you got much the same. So the big difference in 2021 is you actually have less inventory now than you did at any point last year. So you have less available homes for sale. Buyer demand hasn't changed. People are still seeking shelter. They also have this FOMO this fear of missing out. And so people are looking to get in because they see that home prices will likely continue because moratoriums are getting extended, whether it be on the foreclosure side or the eviction side. The CFPB came out in the last couple of days and said that, they're proposing our foreclosure extension through the end of 2021 to not allow any servicers to start the foreclosure process, just to work their way through, the forbearance ending and what have you. So you've got all of these things being pushed off, right? And so it's easy from a fear side to say, once all of this stuff comes to the market, it's going to cause a crash, right? Because prices have continued to rise, since 2011, 2012. And there's been a lot of people sitting on the sidelines waiting for home prices to pull back, waiting for that opportunity to get into the housing market. And it's continued to rise. And so it's really easy to promote fear in that way, because, there's a lot of people that want to buy a house that just aren't in a position financially because, prices are too high or what have you. And so, if you're telling these people, hey, look, there's going to be a crash, there's this opportunity that you're going to be able to buy a house, I'm going to jump on that bandwagon in many ways, right? Because that's what I want. It's no different than politics. You kind of follow what feeds your agenda, so to speak. And in this market, when you've got that fear out there and you've got people that want that to happen, they're going to feed into it. These people are going to continue to make videos and continue to promote crashing and what have you. And here we are, right? And so what you have to understand is that housing prices are built on supply and demand. We've talked about this many, many times. This isn't, anything new. The difference is, in many markets, you have less than a month, month and a half of actual supply of homes on the housing market. What does that mean? That means if no new homes came on the market during that month, month and a half, depending on where the inventory level is in that area, there would be no homes for sale. And so you take that nationwide, take that, and this isn't a problem that's only in the US. This is happening in Europe. This is happening in Canada. This is happening in different markets. So the US isn't alone with home prices and this craziness, but we're here in the US and that's where the majority of viewers are. So that's what I want to talk about. So you have many markets at, let's say, less than a month and a half of supply. So a balanced market, one where it's somewhat equal to buyers and sellers, is somewhere around a 6-7 month supply of homes, right? So if you take, for example, Orange County, California, where I'm located, right now we have about 2,400 homes on the market in all of Orange County. That's 3.3 million people. 2,400 homes on the market, and we're at about a month, month and a half supply of homes. So you got to think, in order for us to get to a balanced market of 6 months, that 2,400 has to double, right? Taking you to roughly, 5,000 homes. And then it has to double again, taking you to 10,000 homes active on the market to even have a balanced market. That's one where sellers don't have control, buyers don't have control. It's equal for both parties, right? So that means that home prices aren't really appreciating, but they're not necessarily depreciating either. It's, level playing field, if you will. So take that nationwide. Now we're just one county here in California, very large state. So you've got to have millions and millions of property come to the market, in order to balance this thing out. And so with moratoriums being extended, evictions being extended, the idea that you're going to have all of these properties come to the market at one time isn't realistic, right? So let's think about this for a second. If you have a couple homes trickle to the market here and there, as these moratoriums open up and different states allow foreclosures to happen or what have you, these properties are going to come to the market. Well, if you've got, every home in a certain area getting multiple offers, people bidding that property, that price up, sometimes $100,000, $200,000 above the asking price. I mean, these are stories coming from you as viewers. Wouldn't you think that if more property came to the market, that you know, those buyers, instead of focusing all of their energy on one of a couple of properties that's actually available, now that those 10, 20 offers would actually disperse to multiple properties. So now instead of having maybe 20 offers on one property, you have 5, 6, 7 on multiple properties, right? Instead of, you know, everybody vying for the same home, now you've got more options, if you will. So more buyers can choose more property, therefore make offers on multiple properties and what have you. So, you know, and at the same time, think prices declined. So now let's use another example for a moment. So people think that when, you know, the foreclosure moratoriums are up, you're going to have these properties hit the market, prices are going to decline or what have you. So that could very well be the case. You might see some decline in prices if you see homes start to come to the market, inventory pick up. I don't personally think it's going to be enough to, you know, cause a crash, but let's just say that there's enough property coming to the market now that you have, again, you have more inventory, more options, and you know, not as much craziness, if you will. So let's just say, for example, you recently made an offer on a house in a neighborhood for $800,000. That seems crazy probably, but here in Southern California, that's, you know, not a crazy price point. In fact, it was pretty normal up until recently. But let's say you were making an offer in on an $800,000 home, and it was one that had multiple offers, right? This is examples from clients that I've had recently, and you were against one of 10 or what have you, and you didn't get it. But let's just say now you got more inventory coming to the market. There's a similar home in that neighborhood that now comes on the market for $750,000. Do you think you might be, you know, in a position or be inclined to make an offer on that property? Because now you were interested at $800,000. Now if one comes on at $750,000, don't you think that you would make an offer? Yeah, and chances are so would every single other person that missed out on that property at $800,000. And now maybe there's a couple of them, right? Maybe there's not just one, there's a couple that you get to make offers on. But the reality is that, you know, there will still be buyer demand, right? If somebody's a buyer at $800,000, if the property comes on less, chances are they're still a buyer because now they get the same property for less money, which might not end up being less money because if you get multiple offers again, it could end up driving that price back up. So think about it from, you know, a standpoint as a buyer or even as an investor. If homes start selling for less than they did just a little bit ago, don't you think buyer demand is going to stay there and continue to drive those prices up? That's my thought, right? I don't think you're going to see enough property come on the market at the same time to really drive down prices because of the way this whole thing's going to roll out. They're not going to allow all of this to happen at one time because it would crush the economy. It would create other issues, and they're just trying to get out of the issues that have been created because of all the stimulus, all the issues that you know, from the moratoriums, from everything that's happened since the pandemic. So, you know, addressing the second question and not continuing to ramble on here about my thoughts on a crash is, you know, should you wait or should you buy? Well, you know, and again, I'm not here to sell you anything. I'm not here to tell you that you should buy a property now or whatever, but I would ask you a couple of questions. What would be your reason for waiting? Is it because you think home prices are going to be less? If that's the case, then I think you should continue to try to purchase now because I do think home prices are going to continue to rise for some time. Now, I'm not going to say they're going to rise all through 2022 and through 2023. Now, there's a lot of people out there that are a lot smarter than I am that think that home prices will continue to rise for the next couple of years. But I do believe that home prices will be more in 6 months than they are right now. Now, if you're in a position where, you know, you might have higher credit scores or you might have, you know, a substantially large down payment because you're getting money coming from some other place, should you wait? Potentially, right? I mean, because, you know, you might be in a better position to purchase then. But if you're a buyer and you think that by waiting, the home that you're looking to buy is going to be less money, I don't think that's the reason to wait. I think maybe you wait because maybe there's more opportunity, maybe because you're going to be in a better position financially. You know, we talked about it the other night. Chances are you can't save money as fast as the market is appreciating, right? The market's going to appreciate faster than you can save money. So, you know, there's many people that purchased a year and a half ago and put 5% down that now have over 20% equity in their homes, right? And if those people would have waited, chances are that maybe in some cases they wouldn't even have been able to purchase. So, you know, I think you've got to consider the reason why you're waiting. Everybody's decision is not going to be the same. Everybody's scenario is not going to be the same. You've got to figure out what's right for you. Again, if you are thinking of waiting because, you know, you think there might be more options or the right one hasn't presented itself and you just don't want to make an offer on something that doesn't check all the boxes, then I think you're right for waiting, right? Don't just buy to buy. Don't buy because you have the fear of missing out. Don't buy because, you know, your friends are purchasing and they're talking about, you know, how much equity they've gained in a year. That's not the reason to buy a house. The reason to buy a house is because it fits your plan, what you're trying to accomplish. Again, that's my thoughts on this idea of a crash, my idea of buying versus waiting. I know a lot of people are asking that question and each person's scenario is a little bit different. You've got to ask yourself those questions, you know, why you're trying to wait, what's important to you in the process, because you know, those are things that myself, you know, and other potential YouTubers, realtors, or what have you can't answer for you. Now, again, you know, my channel is all about providing education and being a guide for you. It, you know, this isn't meant to scare you out of the home buying process or to talk you into buying. It's merely me just giving my thoughts on the housing market so that you can make logical decisions, you know, based on what you're trying to accomplish. But as we get more information on the housing market, updated numbers, updated on, you know, information on moratoriums, evictions, all of that good stuff, I'll continue to update you. You know, I encourage you to leave me comments, ask me questions below, but I appreciate you taking the time to watch. I appreciate the support. We'll see you again soon. Have a great day. Bye-bye.